This is my second video about complex numbers. In the first video, we defined complex numbers and showed how to perform the basic operations, addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. In this video, I want to cover several more topics related to complex numbers, such as raising complex numbers to higher powers and finding the absolute value of complex numbers. I want to do this by first introducing the complex plane and then develop these other topics from a geometric perspective. You may recall that the real number line provided us a useful model to help us understand the real numbers. Every point on the line corresponded to some real number, and every real number had a corresponding point. Complex numbers, on the other hand, are of the form a plus bi. Since a and b can both be any real numbers, we need a separate number line for each value. The easiest solution is to make a rectangular plane, just like the one we use for graphing. This time, however, every point on the plane will correspond to some complex number, and every complex number will correspond to some point. The trick here is to treat complex number a plus bi the same way we do the ordered pair ab. That is, the first component will be the real portion, and the second component will be the coefficient of I. So for instance, the point corresponding to 4 plus 6i will be the same point we use to graph the ordered pair 4, 6. Likewise, the point minus 2, 2 will correspond to the complex number negative 2 plus 2i. You can see that there's a one-to-one matchup between all the points on the plane and the set of complex numbers. You may also notice that every real number is in exactly the same position as before. The real number negative 6, for example, just equals negative 6 plus 0i, so it's on the horizontal real axis at the point negative 6, 0. Just like the real number line often gave us insight into real number operations, this model for complex numbers is useful to describe many complex operations. The idea for the complex plane was developed independently by Caspar Wessel and Jean Argand. In fact, some people still refer to the complex plane as an Argand diagram. The complex plane gives us a way to visualize operations on complex numbers. The rest of this video will consist on examples of this. One easy operation to visualize is the conjugate of a complex number. If z equals a plus bi, then the conjugate of z is a minus bi. The real number values are the same, but the imaginary coefficients take on an opposite sign. So the ordered pair ab is associated with the conjugate ordered pair a minus b. On the complex plane, this has the effect of reflecting the conjugate across the horizontal real axis. You can see two examples here with the complex numbers 3 plus I and minus 2 minus 2i. Another operation with a good geometric interpretation is multiplication by I. If we start with z equals a plus bi, then I times a plus bi will give us minus b plus ai. So our old point ab changes to the new ordered pair minus ba. This new point corresponds to a 90 degree rotation counterclockwise around the origin. Consider z equals 3 plus I. Then I times z is going to equal negative 1 plus 3i. Multiply by I again, and we get minus 3 minus I. Once more yields 1 minus 3i. So continually multiplying by I keeps rotating our point 90 degrees further in the counterclockwise direction. A special case of this that's often useful is to consider what happens when you multiply I times itself. We know, that, for instance, that I squared is equal to negative 1. But what about, say, I to the 201st power? If we start at I, which is 0 plus I on the complex plane, then multiplying I times I will rotate this 90 degrees to negative 1. I cubed will rotate this again to minus I, and I to the 4th rotates this around to 1. You can see the overall pattern below. Every multiple of 4 will just bring us back to 1. Hence, for something like I to the 201st power, we can break this apart into I to the 200th times I, which will equal 1 times I, which is just I. Since 200 is a multiple of 4, I to the 200 should just equal 1. Our third operation is the absolute value of a complex number. The absolute value is sometimes called the modulus. If z equals a plus bi, we define the absolute value of z as the square root of a squared plus b squared. Notice that the absolute value of z is always a real number. Here's a few examples to get you started. If z equals 3 minus 4i, then a is equal to 3 and b is equal to minus 4. So the absolute value of z will be the square root of 3 squared plus negative 4 squared, which is the square root of 25, or just 5. If z equals negative 7 plus I, then a equals negative 7 and b equals 1. Hence, the absolute value of z equals the square root of negative 7 squared plus 1 squared, which is the square root of 50, or 5 square roots of 2. If z equals negative 10, then a is equal to negative 10 and b is equal to 0. So the absolute value of z is equal to the square root of negative 10 squared plus 0 squared, which is the square root of 100, or 10. Notice this is the same result as for real numbers. Finally, if z is equal to negative 6 minus the square root of 13i, then a equals negative 6 and b equals the square root of 13. So the absolute value of z is the square root of negative 6 squared plus the square root of 13 squared, which is the square root of 36 plus 13, which equals the square root of 49, or just 7. So how is this related to the complex plane? Well, as you may recall, one way we had of defining absolute value for real numbers was that it was the distance from the number back to 0 on the number line. This also turns out to be the case for complex numbers. If we have a complex number a plus bi, then we can make a right triangle where the base has length a and the height is b. Now if we define our absolute value as the distance from a plus bi back to the origin, we just have a right triangle and we can find the absolute value of z using the Pythagorean theorem. The absolute value of z squared would equal a squared plus b squared. Or getting the absolute value of z by itself, we once again get the absolute value of z equals the square root of a squared plus b squared. There are, of course, some big differences between the absolute value of real numbers and complex numbers. For real numbers, if we had the equation the absolute value of x equals 2, then there would be only two numbers that were a distance 2 away from 0, those being x equals 2 and x equals minus 2. But for complex numbers, there's an infinite number of points that are a distance 2 away from the origin. Any point on the circle with radius 2 would meet this criteria, including plus or minus 2. There is an alternate form for the absolute value of z that's sometimes a bit easier to remember. If you recall previously, we talked about the conjugate of a complex number. We said that if z was equal to a plus bi, then the conjugate was given by a minus bi. And one of the properties we proved was that if you take z times the conjugate of z, you get a plus bi times a minus bi, which is a squared minus abi plus abi minus b squared I squared, which reduces to a squared plus b squared. So a short way to remember the absolute value is that the absolute value of z is just equal to the square root of z times the conjugate of z. You need to be careful not to confuse the complex plane with the rectangular coordinate system that we use for graphing. They use the same model, but they represent different things. For example, we can use the rectangular coordinate system to graph f of x equals the absolute value of x for real numbers. All the real numbers appear on our horizontal axis, and the height above each on the rectangular plane corresponds to the absolute value of that point. If we want to show the absolute value for complex numbers, we need to go to 3D. Every complex number now appears on the complex plane, and the height of the cone above a complex number corresponds to the absolute value of that complex number. Our final operation for the complex plane just involves addition of complex numbers. You may recall from our previous video that adding complex numbers is quite simple. We treat the two numbers the same way we would two binomials and just add like terms. That is, if z1 equals a plus bi and z2 equals c plus di, then z1 plus z2 equals a plus c plus b plus di. The geometric interpretation for addition is identical to working with vectors. We consider the line segment going from 0 to z1 and the line segment from 0 to z2. Now if we translate the second line segment so that the endpoint that was at 0 gets moved to the end of our z1 segment, then the new endpoint found by moving along both line segments is exactly the sum of z1 and z2. Consider this example with z1 equals negative 3 plus 2i and z2 equals 4 plus 3i. Moving the line segment joining 0 to 4, 3 over to the point negative 3, 2, you can see that our new endpoint is located at 1, 5. And of course, z1 plus z2 is equal to 1 plus 5i. An interesting property that results from this geometric interpretation is the triangle inequality theorem. This theorem states that the absolute value of z1 plus z2 is less than or equal to the absolute value of z1 plus the absolute value of z2. As we observed earlier, the absolute value of z is just the distance from the complex coordinate z back to 0. In other words, it's the length of the line segment joining 0 to z. So the triangle inequality theorem states that by joining your two line segments which have length z1 and z2, that you can't create a new segment longer than their sum. Or if you look at the triangle we formed, you can't have one side of a triangle be longer than the sum of the other two sides. So in summary, we showed that by letting a plus bi correspond to the ordered pair ab, we could create the complex plane. We then showed several applications for this new geometric model, including conjugates, multiplication by I, absolute value, and complex addition. There are, of course, many others, but the ones we presented should give you the basic concepts. So good luck, and thanks for watching.